Hello everyone. You ready for 35 minutes of English with a French accent? Okay. I'm from BASE. I'm one of the founders of BASE. Almost 25 years ago, I founded BASE with friends at school, at the art school. We are today in three cities, in Brussels, New York, and Geneva. More or less 60 people from 14, 15 countries. And we're doing strategy, brand design, and digital design. So I'm going to talk about that. We have amazing clients, and we continue after all these years to work with big clients, medium clients, and small clients. So we have like clients like a big foundation in Paris, like Fondation Yves Saint Laurent Foundation. Louis Vuitton. We work for the Opera in Brussels. We work for the New York Times in New York, the Olympic Museum in Switzerland. We even branded a part of the airport, the JFK airport in New York. So very diverse. We love to learn from different experiences, and we keep on doing that. We also work for brands like we did work for Kipling or Chanel or Pantone. We have things that we believe. We try to deliver great design, but that is accessible. And these are a series of posters I create with my team that are called the 5-minute posters, because I designed them in 5 minutes. So this is one of them. This is another one. It's about beliefs and stuff, and how we see work and how we see our work in communication and branding at BASE. And this is another one. That's a good advice. And we use that also in our communications for BASE. So this is a picture of the party, 20th anniversary party that we throw at MoMA, which is one of our clients also in New York, where we use those sentences as a ready-to-read collection and défilé. More pictures of that. This was a great night. But this is really about how can we also communicate on our beliefs and our point of view of design. We just opened a new store also. So if you want a cool tote bag with some of these sentences, just go on the BASE website. But today the topic is branding, or the branding paradox. And this is really a trend that I guess all of you know, but actually maybe don't realize what is happening now in the field of branding. I was a couple of months ago, a year ago or something, in the subway in New York. And this is what I saw. This is the kind of advertising I was seeing. And I realized that everything was looking the same. Like a very clean approach to branding, same kind of typography, same color background, same kind of naming of the companies. And this was all over the place in the subway in New York. More. And the same way to address people with the tone of voice. Like these companies, like very short name, very clean approach, pastel background, like every of these brands were doing exactly the same thing. This is Closier, for example. And then you would go up in the stairs and see this, and then go in the street, and it will continue by being exactly the same things all over. So, is that branding? I think we're losing the idea of branding here, and we call it branding at BASE. I wrote an article with my friend Tom Greenwood, because basically, branding its main purpose is to differentiate brands, and actually, these brands are just blending in. You don't see the difference anymore between them. So what is the formula for these brands? So the brand formula is, first of all, you take a name that you made up. Like, for example, you use double vowels. Like Google, you would say Upix or Upix, or these kind of names, doubling the vowels. Or you call it with a usual name, like Casper or Jack or Jane. Or you have other called Donut or Butter. You see those brands, that they're everywhere now. The second thing they do is that they're using a clean sensorist typeface. There are things they do. It probably they don't use a logo. They just type the name. Okay. They use a very friendly and accessible tone of voice. They use very cheerful and nice illustrations. And they use some vibrant colors. With lately, they mostly use this purple or kind of light green color. You would see them everywhere. So basically, they're looking like this. This is the global world of blending, where you have tons of these new brands coming in the market and basically presenting themselves the exact same way. So a blend is also mostly telling you this. Me too, I'm innovative, I'm tech disruptive, direct to consumer, I'm online, I will change the world, I'm so cool. Basically, that's the message of all these new brands. The problem is that they all look the same, and that's the environment now. We're submerged with these all same-looking brands. So the question is, what happened? What happened in our environment in branding? I detect three effects that led us to that that thing happening. The first thing is what I call the Pinterest effect. You all know Pinterest. You're probably all using Pinterest. So this is an example of what Pinterest does to us. These are coffee places around the globe. And actually, this is London, Paris, New York, and Mexico. They all look the same. So we are in this sameness environment. And I did a stupid exercise. I went on Pinterest and typed co-working space. It looks like this. So we are in this exactly Pinterest environment. So where is the personality? I'm not saying Fosbury & Sons doesn't have a personality. I'm just asking the questions. These spaces, these environments, these brands, they're all looking the same. So this is the first advice. Forget this tool. Can you just use other ways to get images and information? The second effect is what I call the I want to be effect of these new brands. They want to be what? They want to be successful. So they take Google, Apple, Spotify, Airbnb as example. But these brands, they have a strong personality. They have a super clear purpose since day one. And actually, these brands were looking like this with their logotype. But with time, they changed to this, which is interesting because actually, they don't really need a logo. We all know what Google, Airbnb, or Spotify can do for us. They're becoming commodities for us, which is not the case for new brands. But new brands, we copy these big brands. Also in their interface, they probably look a bit like this, very similar. And Thomas will get back to that in the digital part of our analysis of contemporary branding. The third effect is what I call the teenager effect. So what do teenagers do? Teenagers, they dress all the same, right? So when you see this new brand, they just want to look like cool new brands, so they dress all the same. So again, this is a problem because as a consumer, we need to see a difference between all these brands, and we can't anymore. So that's not enough because an epidemic is spreading. Actually, what we see in these new tech brands is spreading into every other areas and other sectors. Let's take fashion. This is a good Twitter. The rebranding of Burberry. This guy said, I love the way Peter Saville purged the Burberry mark of everything superfluous, like personality, style, heritage, and visual appeal, and included only what was essential, like an explanation of where London is. So we're going from there to there. I'm not saying it's bad. I don't know the strategy behind. I'm just seeing the results. So let's continue. See what happened with all these brands? You probably know this. But this, for some reason, legibility and what we call omnichannel branding, because they need to exist online, on a bag, on a thing. This is more legible, probably, but they all look the same now. It goes even further, this brandless or blending attitude. There's this new brand, in the United States called Brandless. They raised $50 million in funding. This is a little clip of Brandless.
So many vegan options. And only $3?
I'm sold. Who says better has to cost more? That's why we eliminate the middlemen that make national brands more expensive and focused on making hundreds of awesome products at a fair price. Better everything for everyone. All for $3. Start building your brandless box today and get $5 off your first order with code TAKE5.
Oh, let's make it clear. Brandless is a brand, right? It's just another clever idea to make money, and I think it's fair, it's okay, but it's totally a brand surfing on that new trend. So let's go to a reminder. What is the purpose of branding? If you have a brand, what is the purpose of paying us, people like us, to do branding? Basically, if you summarize, there's two purposes. The first one is this one. Brand will sell you stuff, and that's fine because we all need stuff. We need shoes, we need shoes, we need vegetables to eat, we need a new TV, we need all kinds of stuff. So that's the first thing. The second thing, the second purpose is to differentiate for competitors. We need to know the difference between the different brands for us customers to make a choice. So I'm in the business since 25 years, and yesterday for me it was easy. Because you had to pick a name, do a logotype, pick a color, and we were doing branding. It was that easy for us. And some brands are still simply doing that today. Think about yourself. You take a plane, you arrive to an airport, and you have to rent a car. This is what you see. Brand doing that. A logo, a color, and a name. That's it. So what is the difference between these brands? Nada. Nothing. Okay? It's all the same. So, but today it has become much more complicated. This is how it looks. So we have what we call the omnichannel brand experience at the center, and then the brand has to express in every different direction. Social media, store or space, online, the voice, the product, print media, advertising, mobile. And all this works in a very easy way, like this. It's going in every direction. You cannot control that, okay? So what unites that, it's something that we call the brand story, okay? What is the story the brand is telling you? What is your belief regarding that brand? So let's go on Google. What is a brand story? A brand story is what the customer believes about your brand based on the signals your brand sends, okay? It's not what you put on your website. It's what the people believe about your brand. So let's take a very simple example of that. White t-shirts, okay? So these two dudes wearing white t-shirt, the one on the left is a $9 t-shirt. The one on the right is $85, okay? And here in that room, we're totally cool with that. Why? Because this is an H&M t-shirt and this is a Prada t-shirt. Is this a way better t-shirt than the other one? I'm not sure. But we agree with that, because the brand story tells us that it's okay to pay almost 10 times the price for almost the same product. So this is interesting, because where is that happening for the customer? It's not happening here in your head, it's happening here in your belly. It's emotional. There's nothing you can control about that. So you think about some brands that you like and others that you don't, and you almost don't know why. Oh, I hate this brand. Oh, I love this brand. Why? You can't explain somehow. It's emotional. So this is really important about branding. What I do is not working for a brand. What we do is branding on the is working on the perception of a brand. So a guy, pretty clever, called Martin Neumeier said that. It's a person's gut feeling about a product, a service, or organization. You need to think about that when you come up with a brand. And also said that. So a brand that will succeed is any product, service, or organization for which people believe there is no substitute. Is there a substitute to Martin Margiela? Is there? Is there a substitute to Nike? These are strong brands for good reasons, probably. So at base, we have a belief. We just compare brands to people, and we believe that strong brands are those with a unique personality and a strong attitude. So, how would you describe this guy? Adjectives in your head. How would you describe Putin? Do you know him? No, you don't, but you know him. So probably he's cold, he's strategic, is tough. How would you describe this woman? Different, right? We don't know them, but we have a perception on how they are, how is their personality. Same with brand. How would you describe Nike? How would you describe Chanel? Immediately we would have adjectives and reaction, an emotional reaction that would make you love or hate or be totally indifferent to them. So the question is, what is the brand personality? What makes a strong brand? So I will give you here two examples you all know probably. First one is this one. Do you know Veja? Okay. There's somebody in the crowd here that likes Veja? Why? You? Okay, why? They have a point of view. They have an attitude. I don't know if their shoes are way better than other, but for example, they're not spending any money on advertising. They don't spend any money on branding, actually, because they decide to eliminate ads, marketing costs, doing away with all that, because they want to spend all their money and being a sustainable, good brand with good relationship with their producer in Brazil. That's an attitude. A strong brand today and tomorrow need to have a strong point of view or attitude. Second example, we all know Volvo. What comes into your mind if you think about Volvo? What word? Yeah. Security, no? Security. This is the new commitment of Volvo for 2020. They call it aiming for zero. Our vision is that by 2020, nobody should be killed or seriously injured in a new Volvo. Who else than Volvo can claim that? They are the only one. It's a strong brand because it's totally consistent of what they claim and how they do it. Okay? So the question is how to be this kind of new brand and how to create an expressive brand. I'm going to show you four examples of work that we did both in the US and here in Europe. The first one is Time Stock for the New York Times. We all know New York Times. That's a good brand, okay? So it was easy already for us to work for them in that sense. And what they ask us is to brand this things called Time Talks, which are basically they invite people and they have discussion on stage about topics. So great people, clever people. It's an amazing moment. So this is what we did as a branding. Is we did more than a logotype or something. We invented a system for them. This is how it works. Always two types, know what next, know what comes. And this always takes the shape of a dialogue. You can change color backgrounds. Always a picture in the middle with the guest and always a dialogue. It is linked to real events that makes the brand very strong as well. It's real people, real moments. This is what we did for Time Talks. But more than that, we helped them to work quickly because the problem for them was to produce that very quickly, all this advertising for them. So we designed this, which is a little interface that now we designed for some of our clients, and Thomas can explain you later about that as well. And this is, for example, this little interface on how they can use that. They upload an image, can go bigger, smaller, pick the color, and it gives you other color that goes with. So you can go very fast by producing everything and then download the image. These are some posters. This is the website. So you see that everything is created as an ecosystem. So print, digital, branding is not separated anymore. We create everything at the same time. It's an iterative process between the different people that are working in our company. And obviously, the importance today of good storytelling, video, is crucial. This Grace Jones on stage, four times dogs, and other examples of posters. Another example is a job we just finalized in Paris. And it is in the fashion business, but in education. Do you know this place? It's called IFM, it's Institut Français de la Mode. And we won the competition to rebrand the Institut, basically for one reason. IFM was super well known by being one of the most important school in business of fashion. They would merge with École de la Chambre Syndicale de la Couture Parisienne, which was super strong in all what is savoir-faire and technique. But also, they wanted to get the third super important part of fashion, which is creation, the third part of fashion. So basically, the first line of the brief was like, we want to become the first fashion school in the world. And we need a new rebrand for that. So what did we do? The first issue that we noticed is the fact that we had to merge people from two different schools. So the first thing is put them together. And this is something that probably you'll have also as an explanation after with Waters and Hendrix. This is what we do at the beginning of every job. Putting in the room all the people that will define the brand. We're not working out of the vacuum at base. We need to have information and true and gut emotion from the people working in that company or in that brand. So we put them together, and we did all sorts of exercise to define the vision of the company, where they want to be, the personality, the promise, the difference. And so we make them work like hell. So we would get all the information. And this is, for example, the exercise we did about personality. And then we come up, and that is also very important. Usually, when we ask an agent, when you would ask an agency to do a strategy, the strategy will be like a 60-page document or even more, 100-page document. And we don't believe in that at base. We believe that people don't like to read 60-page document for a strategy. So we try to put that on a one-pager. The one-pager, we call it the Atomium, or we call it the Brand Compass. And you have here the mission, the personality, experience, promise, and difference. And these things are just guidelines for everyone in the company from that exercise, both to do the branding, but also to evolve towards their future they define together. This is super important for us because we will use that as a guideline to design the brand. And also we can use it to tell our client, hey, remember, you said that. This is why we're doing that. For example, the difference for them was like difficult to know what the difference is. What do you have that nobody else has? And at EFM, it was easy for us. The difference was Paris. If you compete again, St. Martin's in London or the school here in Antwerp or La Combe in Brussels, when you can propose to people coming from Korea or other countries, hey, you want to do fashion in Paris? This is very attractive, and that's their difference. So this seems very easy. It took us almost a month and a half or 2 months to end up with that and to have an agreement on that. So then we started to design, because we needed to design and come up with the branding of this new French fashion school. First thing that we design is a typeface. So we create this custom typeface. And why typeface is important? Because typeface is the voice of the institution. That's why you see now a lot of brands having custom typeface, because when you see it, you just know what is the brand here. And the typeface we designed was like a very classic and elegant typeface, but we insist on this accent. The second thing that we did, which was very rare for them, is to mix English and French. They were like, no, we speak French. We're like, yes, but you wanna address people from across the globe to come here. So we will mix it. So we come up with this kind of very goofy and stupid idea about how to address that for young student from across the globe, and we bring that English French mixed up in everything they were saying. So that was the second point. So already, when we design a poster only with types, you don't need a logo. You see that is the school talking to you. Then there was the images, and that's where again, instead of doing that on our side, we decided to do that together with them. They're fashion people, they know, they're even better than us at our directing. So it was like, okay, let's look for great photographers together, and then they would do the art direction of the shooting. So we did that, this some of the picture we did together. Some are very like fashiony like this, but other are very light and about the work of being a student in a fashion school. Other pictures here. So the very important part of that is that it becomes not our brand, it's their brand. They start to play with it. So another element that we bring is this idea of patron. And so we designed a lot of them. It's also a graphic element that would be very recognizable for the school. So we have the typography, we have the imagery, we have the patron, we have, and then we mix all this together. So it starts to look like this, mixing the languages, mixing the typography, and starting to use also movement and video in there. So then it becomes very easy, and they had an internal team, to implement that, because it's their brand, they have what we call at BASE the toolbox. The toolbox is the simple tool to use to implement the brand. This is inside the school. They really like that sentence, for example. The schools that makes fashion, that makes the schools that makes fashion. So it's a never-ending sentence that they used in the entrance of the school. This is how it's used in the bibliothèque. And then inside the school everywhere. And then on the digital side, our team work with them, and this is how it looks on mobile, and this is how it looks on the website. So the website had to be like of a kaleidoscope. They said, we want our school to be with a new energy, with a new approach to everything we're doing. You should see how EFM was looking like before that. It was like stiff and boring, and now it's really like an open door where it's really easy to go immediately to the content you're interested in. So this is the team of EFM we work with, and they were super happy at the end, not so much because BASE was good or whatever, it's because they did it themselves with us. So our role is really how to help every of our clients to reveal what they truly are. Another example, let's go to Beirut in Lebanon. Well, we were called by a guy and a company called Mitsulift, and they were selling elevators. And we're like, what elevators? We don't want to work for the elevator company. So, yeah, kind of like, why would we do that? And the guy was exceptional because he was saying, we do elevators, but I don't care about that. We do that super well. What I'm interested in is in the people. He said, We work in the Middle East, we're leader in the Middle East, we are also implemented in Africa, and actually the cities in Africa and Middle East will grow tremendously in the coming 20 years. So people will not travel so much like this horizontally, they will travel more and more vertically. Hey BASE, do you want to take care of vertical travel? Well, sure we do, it's great. So we come up with a stupid and very obvious idea. We come up with a simple gimmick in their communication. Looks basically like this. Simple typeface, and it's just simply going up and down. That's it, that's the idea. But when you have an idea, we believe at BASE you have to use it all the time. So, okay. So this is how it looks on paper. So you see it's, again, a whole work of putting together in the same room the digital people, copywriters, storytellers, graphic designers. These are all the people at BASE working on these different projects, and that's the conjunction of everything that makes the brand. So it goes from business cards to inside their building, their offices, and that's inside the atelier. Finally, there's a brand that you probably know, which is Studio Brussels, that we redid. I'm not an expert in Studio Brussels because I'm French-speaking, but all the Dutch-speaking people are really attached to the brand. So you know that we are the former logos, and it was really strikeful on how people were attached, but that somehow the brand of Studio Brussels was not anymore what it was, and they wanted to go back to the roots and the true essence of Studio Brussels. So again, we worked with them on this. And again, basically, how would you come to vibrations and music in visuals, in typography? And basically, we create that typography that would glitch and that would be reactive to sound. So that's, one of the first elements of the toolbox that we created with them at Studio Brussels. The second thing was imagery. We shot these with Salinas here. What's his? Very simple flash shot pictures. The second element. So that's the logo. That's the new logo of Studio Brussels. And it's incredible. Actually, no one said, but actually you change it. You change it to Stubru. No, everybody was saying Studio Brussels, Stubru, no problem. And basically what you see here is bringing back a good energy in the brand. And this is one of our role also at BASE is to bring the energy. So this is how you can use the logotype, meaning whatever you want to do with it, you can do it with it. And it can be horizontal, you can use these different colors, or you can use it in two lines. That's how it looks in the studios. Microphones. And what was really exciting is that we gave them the tools to play with, and immediately they were starting to doing their own posts on Instagram and doing their own stories, their own videos, and that's why, again, they were part of the creative process. And that for us at BASE, it's really important how you bring your client and being part of the creative process. More images, ideas on how to design and bring Studio Brussels back on the stage. This is their Instagram now. You see, it's totally new energy, and we could feel they were so happy to use that. And actually, the rebranding was a success. We got a lot of positive feedback, and it was tough because it was a brand that a lot of people loved, and we had to be careful with that. We had to respect that. So of course, again, it's to bring the right people on board, like video producers, copywriters, typographers. This is how the website looked like. We had to keep the actual website. We changed. We did a facelift, and then how it will look in the street. And this is where we worked with our ad agency called Mutant, where we decided to do rock posters, and we just cover the streets of Brussels with these kind of like free. Guerrilla posters across the city. This is how it looks, totally uncontrolled, and they really liked that. It was really back to the spirit of Studio Brussels. And then I think a month later, we saw this at the Ronde van Vlaanderen, and that was fun. They designed their own shirts using the typeface, and I think it looks great. So a final note on that. There was a study, I think it was 2 months ago, in Creative Review, and it was interesting. They interviewed like more than 1,000 people in different countries, And a lot of these people about their perception about branding and brands. 65% thinks that all brands look alike. So there's something to be done here. So these are some results of this. The second is 68% say brands all sound alike. 72 say brands are predictable. 73 say brands play it safe. And probably most importantly, 80 people believe brands focus on sales over people and culture. And at BASE, we believe that branding is building culture, is building our own common culture. And this is really important to us. So that's my final word on this. Say no to this. Just be creative and expressive with your brand. Say no to branding. That's it for today. Thank you.